I get more out of it than I think y'all do. So it's kind of like it works out cool. What I wanted to share on today is the arena of the mind. The arena of the mind. Like we said last time, your soul is a three-part being. You have your mind, your will, and your emotions. God puts his thumbprint on everything. Isn't that so cool? I mean, there's no way you can deny him or shake him because he puts his thumbprint on everything. And then he lets man take the next 6,000, 7,000 years trying to figure it all out. And so even with the arena of your mind, you're a three-part being. Your mind is memory, it's contemplation, and imagination. Now this isn't a psychology bit, that's not my vibe, you know, at all. But we have to focus on the arena of the mind because everything that the enemy launches against you is gonna come through your mind. That is the battlefield, and that's where he's gonna launch all of his attacks. If he's gonna lie to you, he's gonna lie to your thought life. As believers, I think sometimes it's difficult for us to judge and to gauge what the difference is between a lie and the truth. Because every lie the enemy tells you has a little bit of truth in it. But you know, I tell people like this, especially, you know, people that I spend a lot of time on discipling, a half truth is a whole lie. A half truth is a whole lie. And so it's important to understand that you're responsible for your own thought life. And one time when I was, you know, in youth ministry and I first got born again and was helped heading up a youth ministry at a church, we had a kid that, you know, every time a bad thought would come through his head, you know, he was so cute in the way he did. He'd be like, oh, no, that's not my thought. That's not my thought. That's not my thought. No, that's not my thought. You know, he'd be sitting in the van going somewhere and he'd just be talking to himself. We're like, you know, John, you don't have to, you know, say that every time it comes in. I mean, it's good that you're ready, but I mean, that you're going to get tired. And that's what happens is it tends to boggle your mind when the enemy launches attacks. Because whenever you make a statement like you're responsible for your own thought life, people immediately say, well, you don't know what's going through my head, and I don't know how to stop it. And so we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about, we're going to touch on some stuff in Ephesians 6. You know, the Bible is so... God gives you an answer for everything, and there's nothing the enemy can bring that he has not already provided the answer for. Where we miss it is a knowledge problem. You don't have any other problem in your life but a knowledge problem. That's it. I don't care what you're facing, whether it's something in your marriage, your body, finances, business. The only problem you have is a knowledge problem. And once you get knowledge on a situation, Holy Ghost revealed knowledge, the whole situation changes. And so that's what I want to touch on. I want to touch on how to block demonic thought patterns. And so I'm just going to give you some real practical things on how to guard your mind and how to block the enemy from what the Bible calls in Ephesians 6, he calls those fiery darts. And a fiery dart is something that's a loss against your thought life. You may just be driving down the road and all something, bam, something just comes in and it begins to affect your mood, it begins to affect your heart, it may begin to affect how you feel. And so the Bible gives us clear direction on how to defeat those things. How many of y'all want to know what it is? Okay, I'm going to pass an offering bucket first. I'm just joking. This is a goofy joke. I don't have any good jokes. At least Joel has some. All my jokes stink. So first and foremost, if you want to change your thoughts, you have to change on what you feed on. This is what the enemy likes to do. And I label it as a demonic insinuation. I don't know if that's a good term. It works for me. Maybe it works for you. A demonic insinuation, whereas the enemy, he comes to you and he plants a thought in your head. And anytime he plants a thought in your head, you have to do one or two things immediately. You either have to recognize that's a thought from the enemy, and you have to verbally, we fight thoughts with words. We don't fight thoughts with thoughts. And you verbally have to confess against what that, contrary to whatever that thought is. So if the enemy comes to you and says, you have cancer, and it just comes out of the blue. I had that happen to me one time, so I like to use that example. I was just driving down the street, and I had my grandfather had died of cancer. I had an aunt that died of cancer, and the enemy just spoke straight to my head, and he says, I'm gonna kill you too. Just like that. And he began to plant these thoughts and tell me that I was sick, that I was gonna, and it was no symptoms whatsoever. I'm healthy as they come. I'm healthy as they come. But this, the enemy was trying to get me to agree with his lie. And when you agree with it, you begin to give him authority. Whatever it is. Whether it's poverty, whether it's, you know, you're never going to find a husband and wife, whether it's you're never going to prosper, whatever the case is, he has to get you in agreement with his lies before he can bring the fruit. And so what I want you to begin to do is it all takes practice. That's what a disciple is. A disciple is a self-disciplined learner under the lordship of Jesus Christ. That's what it means. We are disciples of Christ. You are a self-disciplined learner under the lordship of Jesus Christ. And so what you begin to do is, I begin to, right here in my car, I don't know if anybody's driving next to me. If they did, they thought I was nuttier than a Chinese chicken salad, because I was sitting there saying, no, in the name of Jesus, I am healthy. All the days of my life, I walk in divine health. Lord gives me wisdom in what I eat, how I exercise. I rebuke that thought. It is not mine. I don't receive it. And I cast it down in the name of Jesus. And man, it came back immediately. It was a war. And then it stopped. And I kid you not, about 3 weeks later, the same thing happened. I don't remember where I was the second time, but it came right back. And so if we don't have the word in us, and we don't know how to confess and break these things down spiritually, sooner or later he tries to break us down through the war of attrition. How many of you know what that is? The war of attrition is many small attacks over a period of time to break you down. It's not one blitzkrieg. It's not one massive attack to come against you and just assault you and get you to accept his lies. No, it's a little bit at a time. It's a little bit at a time. So it's like, I look at it like this. It's like the waves on a shore. They come in. And you know what? He's never going to stop. The only thing we can do is get better and get stronger. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible says, Romans 12, what does it say? It says, and be ye transformed by what?
Renewing.
The renewing of your mind. Your mind does not get saved. It has to be renewed. It has to be renewed, and it has to be renewed according to the word of God. Which means that when the enemy comes, you have to have something contrary to speak against him. If you don't, his seeds begin to take root, and then they begin to bear fruit. This is a deal he wants you to do. And this is what I kind of went on the rabbit trail right there, but this is what I wanted to focus on, is this. Is that when the enemy plants a seed in your head, what he's trying to get is your heart. We talked about this last time. I believe the heart is the deepest place of a human being. I believe it's where the soul and the spirit meet. Because your soul and your spirit, they look very much alike. They look very much alike. You can still do good things that aren't God. You can still do things, you know, even not being born again. I remember I did nice things. I did good things, but yet life was not in me. But it was just good. You with me? Doesn't necessarily mean it was God. And so the soul and the spirit is where the word of God comes to break those things in two, so that you can discern which is which. And what happens is when you continue to meditate on a thought, it gets into your heart. And when it gets into your heart, then you have a more serious issue. Because when it gets into a deeper level of you, the warfare changes. It's no longer just when a thought comes, you can break it with your words. You can replace it with another thought. There's a lot of things you can do. When stuff gets in your heart, it's a little bit more difficult to combat, because you have to combat it in a different way. And so what happens is that this cycle begins to take place between our thought life and our heart. Our thought life and our heart. And it keeps us in a place of perpetual imbalance. It keeps us in a place of bondage. It keeps us in a place to where we can't think the thoughts of God, because there's something in our heart. Look, you will always rotate to what you believe in your heart, no matter what you believe in your head. Your heart will always override your head all the way. Now, you can get to your heart through your head. But your heart, you can sit here and say, I'm blessed. You know, we walk in church and we know how to say it, don't we? I mean, I'm blessed. How are you? I'm blessed, brother. I'm blessed, sister. You know, we know what to say. But if you don't believe that truth in your heart, you will never see it manifested in the earth. Because your heart overrides. If you shall believe in your what and confess with your mouth, the Bible says. Believe in your heart. It's with the heart that man's believed. So you have to be careful of what takes residence in your head, because if you don't, it'll get into your heart. And it will manipulate and control every area of your life. How am I doing so far?
Awesome.
Genesis chapter 3, I believe it is. I didn't plan on going here, but let me just try to touch on something real quick. I like going back to Genesis because it's very simple. It's the beginning of all things before religion got involved. You know, we can see what God's original intent was. Before the enemy got involved, we can see where things begin to go awry or get a little bit off course because of what the enemy did. I love Genesis because it gives us the original kingdom law. And so when it talks about the fall of man in Genesis chapter 3, the serpent comes to Eve first. And the Lord had already said, you can have any tree in the garden, but this one here, don't touch it. He instituted the tithe right there. It was all the way back in the garden. He said, this is mine. Anything else you can have, but this is mine. This is unto me. And so the enemy begins to come immediately. And it was a tree of what? It was a tree of knowledge. A tree of knowledge of good and evil. So we have all these cute stories growing up in Sunday school of the apple. How many of y'all remember that whole story of the apple? You know, you color in the little cartoon thing of the apple. You know, the Bible doesn't say anything about an apple, but boy, I was coloring it, you know, and for the next however many years, I always believed it was an apple, you know, just like I believed Jonah got swallowed by a whale, you know. It's a big fish. I mean, it is what it is, but here's the deal. If you have an apple tree, it produces what?
Apples.
This is good. We're smart. If you have an orange tree, it produces what?
Oranges.
If you have a knowledge tree, it produces what?
Knowledge.
It produces thoughts. And so when the enemy came and the fruit that she had to take was the fruit that she took in her thought life. He attacked her between her ears. It wasn't even necessarily verbal. We don't know what that looked like. I mean, there's so many. Adam was such a unique creature made in the likeness and the image of God. There's a lot of things Adam, his mind was on a whole nother level. You know, our brains, the way God made them, they are highly powerful. You know, because of certain things now, mostly because of the weight of sin, I believe man has kind of digressed, you know, mentally. But what I'm saying is I believe that whenever Adam wanted to move somewhere, I think he just moved by the speed of thought. I think he just thought, I just want to be there, and he was there. Now, that's just me. Because, you know, you realize that there's no sin in the world. His mind he has 100% mental capacity. 100%. They say a genius uses, you know, less than 10%. So I'm probably at about 11 or 12, easy. And so when she took the thought, that's where she didn't have anything to combat it with. And when you take a thought and begin to try to reason with the enemy, he's got you. Have you ever told yourself, have you ever wanted to do something you knew wasn't right? You don't have to raise your hand. I mean, have you ever just wanted to do that one sin that you knew wasn't right? Or you just knew, you know, everybody has that sin that so easily besets some type of deal. You know, especially growing up, getting stable in the things of God, you know, you're having to renew your mind, you're having to break old thought patterns, you're having to break different types of habits, and you know you shouldn't do something, and God's dealing with you, man, you're in that place where you're like, man, but I want to do it. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Have you ever tried to battle that on a mental level, and has it worked for you consistently? Have you ever told yourself, I'm not going to do that, I'm not going to do that, I'm not going to do it, I'm not going to do it, you're battling in your thought life. The enemy already has you. He already has you. If you start wrestling with him and boxing with him in your thought life like that, he's got you because you're reasoning with him. It has to be on a heart level. Father, move in my heart. Move in my desires. My head's da 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 da, but move in my heart. It's, you know, I surrender my heart to you. I continue to feed on it. Move in my heart that I don't have the desire. There's certain things I don't have the desire for and never will. You know? I don't have to go into it, but it is what it is. There's just certain things that I will never, it's just impossible for me to do. Because there's just absolutely no desire. You with me? So if we combat him on the level of desire, that's a deeper level to fight. That's a heart level. But if we fight him in our thoughts, with just our thoughts alone, he's going to get us. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So how do we fight thoughts? We fight thoughts with what?
Words.
With words. And what's the best word you can use? It's the word of God, correct? Because if you don't, he puts demonic insinuations, which means he insinuates things to you. Look, smoke and mirrors can't kill you. When it comes to the enemy, smoke and mirrors can kill you. What's not really there, if he can get you to agree with it, it can get you. So your mind is important. Being careful what you listen to music-wise, big time. Big time. Look, there's a lot of music I loved back in the day. And I even loved it, even as a believer. Praise God and amen. Some of it probably not the best, godliest stuff in the world to be feeding on. But even as I fed on those things, I began to see certain patterns in my life that lined up with what I was listening to. Music gets into you. TV, television, Lordy. The best thing we can do is keep those things turned off for the most part. Because if you don't have a vision for your life, it will tell a vision for you. You know what I mean?
Yes.
It'll give you an idea what life should look like. Yeah, you should be, you know, 30 pounds less. Yeah, and you shouldn't be with that man. Or you shouldn't be with that woman. Or, you know, you should have 5 cars. Yeah, you do deserve all this, even though you can't afford it. Just buy it on credit. So you have to control your thought life. You have to be careful what you put in. Because the enemy's going to try to reach you through your ears and through your eyes. So if he can't get you any other way, he's going to try those two ways right there. But you guard it by being careful what you listen to or what you watch. Is there any questions so far before I move on? Any questions? Anybody have anything they want to ask? Anything they want to say? Does anybody like my shirt?
Yeah.
How's my hair?
That's pretty nice.
All right. I'll just piggyback on what you're saying about the fear thing. I remember when I was little, I went somewhere and I got this fear of heights. And after that, I kept on continuing. Then I conquered that. I just started doing things that, you know, high stuff, climbing mountains and stuff like that. One time I was climbing a mountain, and all of a sudden I heard this voice say, jump. So I thought I was being weak, you know, hearing that voice. And I'm conquering my fear, and heard it jump. I didn't do it until I'm here right now. But I didn't do it, but yeah. I heard another preacher speak about that, and he's talking about thought life. Those things do come in your head. You know, whatever it is, they will come at you at certain points. You think you're strong, that thought will come in your life. You just have to keep on going for it. The next time I climbed a mountain, I took people with me that never climbed one. And I took them on a journey. And I remember when I did that, I didn't even think about, you know, being on the side of a cliff, you know, this high and stuff like that. Because I took somebody with me, too.
But. Yeah, it's very, and he said, he gave a key point right there. That's why I love hearing people talk, because it always stirs something different up. You did it last time I spoke to you, man. Me and you, you're my helper. You're hired. He said something very important, and I want us to catch this seriously. I want to really just piggyback on what he said and maximize this moment, because he said that I want to be strong. Ephesians 6, which is the warfare chapter of the New Testament, teaches us how to battle in the spirit realm. If you're having issues with the enemy or how to combat him, Ephesians 6 lays it out. But Ephesians 6 starts out in the beginning. It says, be strong in the Lord.
Yes.
Be strong in the Lord. You don't have to be strong in your own strength, because the strength of man looks different. The strength of man can look like many different things. But being strong in the Lord looks just like one thing, and that's fearing him, obeying him, and walking with him. Being strong in the Lord. And so the enemy, he can tempt you by saying, you're not strong because you're not doing this or you're not doing that. And he constantly tries to feed you and to bait you. I mean, I really have to. I know there's different ears in the room, but you know, we have just different things that come against our young people. You know, telling them to make decisions that are eternal, even at a young age. That's a spirit, and we have absolute authority over all of them. So it's important that we teach our young ones how to battle. We teach them how to love real good. But sometimes we don't teach them how to fight. Not necessarily the natural, I'm talking spiritually speaking. One thing I really try to impart my nieces and nephews is how to fight. How to take care of yourself in the spirit. How to watch out different thoughts. I mean, young people just like us, I mean, anytime the enemy wants to attack a seed, he's going to do it in infantile stages. And That's just a tactic of spiritual warfare. Anytime you can attack something in its infantile stage, it's most vulnerable. So when you sense the enemy launching something against your business, when you sense the enemy launching something against your ministry, or you sense the enemy trying to launch something against you at the job site, when you feel it or sense it here, that's the Holy Spirit giving you a red flag. There's an assignment on you. We're believers, and if I was to sit up here and tell you don't have crosshairs on your back, I'd be lying to you. The enemy would love to ruin your witness. He would love to ruin how you live in front of people. He would love to say that you serve a God that has no power. He would love to do those things. Mm-hmm. And so when you sense something here, that something's not right, begin to really, if you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit, you absolutely must be. Because then you can now begin to download what heaven's trying to say to you without having to figure it out in your head.
Amen.
The power of tongues is important. And so when you can attack that thing in its seed form, it's easier to kill. Anything the enemy tries to do. That's why with Jesus, when did the enemy really try to kill him? First. When he was a baby. Because the longer that seed grows, the more it gets root, the harder it is to kill. Anything. Anything. If God's going to unfold something in your life, a plan, a promise, if He gives you, if there's a promise that He's given you, and you begin to move out, you have to understand you're vulnerable. You're vulnerable in seed form. So anytime that you begin to sense something, attack it immediately. You attack it by prayer. You attack it by exposing, praying, Father, expose whatever this trap is. Expose whatever it is. Show me. Cause the enemy to make mistakes and reveal his position. That's how you pray those things. And so when the enemy, when you sense it, you begin to attack it, and then it can never take root. It can't bear fruit. But if you wait till you absolutely see all the results of what you felt months ago, now you're dealing with it in a more mature form, and you can't deal with it the same way. Now you have to deal with it by moving with other believers, because now you're moving with something that's much more mature. When it's in seed form, you can attack it easily. But when it's bearing fruit and it's taking root and it's growing up, now you have to find other believers. And sometimes it's even hard finding other believers that know about these type of things. Not that I'm any different, not that I'm above anybody. It's just sometimes people just don't know. They haven't been exposed to it. So sometimes it can be hard to find the right people to walk with you. Because you just may say something and they just, all right, brother, God bless. You know, and you're like, no, you know, I'm in something's heavy here. Something, oh no, okay, all right, we'll be praying for you. When somebody tells me that, I don't believe them. I don't trust anybody else with my prayer life. That's just the truth. I'm thankful for it. I'm you know, kind and all that. Thank you for your prayers, but I don't believe them. I don't know what they're praying. You know, it makes me nervous. And so, whenever you can sense something in a seed form, attack it then. Because when it begins to bear fruit, it's harder. That's why the enemy attacks people when they're young. A lot of the things that we deal with as adults, this isn't new stuff that's come against us. This is stuff that was launched against us as children. Through things like, in my life, divorce, losing my father, you know, not having that relationship with him, having critical moments, but nobody to walk me through them. Yes. And so it was then that the enemy whined, because I was in seed form. So you have to understand, if the enemy launched an attack against you in your childhood that was unfair, you have to understand that you absolutely must have some seed in there that he knew was dangerous. Because the greater the attack in seed form, the more he's worried about what's on the inside of you.
That's right.
So he says that if I don't attack this person now, if I don't get this now, when this thing begins to mature, it is going to war and weary my kingdom. Yeah. So he has to attack people when they're young. So he has to remove the man. He has to have things like divorce. He has to have men feeding on crazy things in their private life. Because if he can remove a man, he can remove the legal authority in God's eyes as far as the head goes. Doesn't make a man any stronger than a woman other than just basic rank and file, which is how the spirit realm works.
Yeah.
It works on rank and file. I was sharing last night with the singles out of Daniel chapter 10 about how he began to pray and he began to fast. And he fasted 21 days. And then the angel Gabriel finally comes through and says, you know what? From the first day that you prayed, your prayer was heard. But when I was coming through, I was held up by the prince of Persia. It was a demonic prince. And he said, I was held there. And he said, but yet I had to call on the chief angel Michael to come in and to help me. That is a blueprint that is heavy right there.
Yes.
Why Gabriel being an angelic host on the winning side, we have all power and authority. We are not on the losing side. We have 2/3 of the angel, Jesus, and the Word of God, so I'm not sitting here worried and crying about nothing.
Amen.
But we have to understand the rules of engagement. Gabriel is not a warring angel. That's not his assignment. That's not his anointing. That's not what he was created to do. He's a messenger. He's created to release higher level information. And so in doing that, when he meets a warring angel, he realizes that that's not my assignment. I'm a messenger. I cannot war with this thing. So what does he do? He calls on Michael, who is a warring angel of the kingdom of light. Now it's rank on rank. And so whenever Michael shows up on the scene, breaks free, Gabriel's released, able to bring the answer in the earth. That's how the spirit realm works. It works on rank and file. And everything God does, he put his thumbprint on. So when he made the family and he made man, he made us with his thumbprint on it. Rank on file, man as the head, wife beside him as one, moving as one unit, the children underneath that. That's the order of God. Even in the local church, we have pastors, the set man, the set woman. We have elders underneath them. Then we have what we call lay ministers. It's rank on file. So if you begin to, as a elder, begin to try to combat against a pastor, you are now legally out of order. Doesn't mean that pastors are always right. This means we recognize rank and file. Yeah. And so when it comes all the way down to us as human beings and the way that we're made and created, we have to be in order. You are a spirit. You have a soul. You live in a body. That is the way God made you. Your spirit is to be king, your soul to be servant, your flesh to be slave. That's the order of God. If your flesh begins to make decisions in your life, things are now out of order. And now your life will not represent what God wants for you to have in the spirit. It's going to represent what the enemy wanted you to have in the flesh. So we have to keep those things in order. And we do that by guarding our thought life, feeding on the word, and keeping ourselves disciplined. Fasting is a big one. If you fast, it's the easiest way to get you. If you say, Damon, I'm out of order in my life, some areas, join the club. The easiest way to get back in is to begin to fast. It will bring you into a divine alignment so quick. So that you don't have to sit there and live in the flesh for months and years to come and wreck your life. Does that help anybody this evening?
Yeah, amen.
This
yeah.
morning, I'm sorry.
Amen.
That was great.
Is there anybody has any other questions? I think we're about closing time, right?
Sure.
Is there any, before we close in prayer, is there anybody that has anything they want to add, anything they want to ask, say? Speak now and forever hold your peace.
I just want to say something real quick.
Sure.
We went, Carlos took me to my very first professional football game. It was, it was my very first one. So we had tickets, and it was the, who was it, Texans and somebody else. But long story short, our seats were way, way up there. And the first thing that I got set free from was fear, and that was the year 2000. Like lay hands on fear, Holy Spirit, and saved all at one time. So that tried to come back around again. I was so fearful at that moment where I got up, three or four times to get up there, and I was shaking and trembling, and I thought I was going to fall over the edge. I mean, debilitating fear. Mm. So I went out into the lobby and kept praying it down. It took, for me, it felt like 2 hours. But you said it was, 10 minutes? But I kept saying what you said, fear, you must go. And I kept speaking, Jesus, Jesus, and I tried to go back in again. I had to turn around again. So, I mean, I was speaking the word of God is that I am fearfully, wonderfully made. I kept speaking all these things. I am not born in the spirit of fear. I have power, love, and a sound mind. Must I remind you, Satan, that I'm a daughter of the Most High God? Because I was praying this and praying this and praying this. And then he's like, what's wrong with you? He came over and he's like, what's wrong? Did the food not agree with you? Because you don't get milk. So, but I just said, no, I'm battling fear. I was like shaking, So finally it went away. He like pressed my hand. And then I finally went out and they asked me to be a Whataburger person, like up on the big screen. So whatever that was, it was fear chasing me down. And I wanted to give certificate. It was chasing me down. And my point is that was from 2016. So that thing, as a child, it was fear-based. Mm-hmm. It really was. It's a whole testimony itself. But it was broken off, and it tried to come back again 16 years later.
Yeah.
I'm
telling you, every time somebody talks, it just brings up another point. I don't want to, and I'm not going to.
Go ahead. You got it. We'll let you know, like, the five-minute point.
The deal is this. She said something very important. Again, she said, I was delivered and set free from that thing in 2000. Here it is, 2016. here's what we have to understand. This is our confession. Our confession has to be this, that I'm healed, maintaining my healing,
yes,
and that I'm delivered, maintaining my deliverance. In the church, we like that magic wand stuff. You know, if God came to you and healed you and said, you know what, I can heal you if you'll quit eating hamburgers and french fries. Because that's the issue. That's what's feeding someone. And you'd be like, well, I like hamburger and french fries. You know, I want Benny Hinn to take his jacket off and wave it over me. That's how I want to get healed. Because it relieves me of all responsibility. So after he waves his jacket and I still go eat hamburgers and french fries, now it makes God look silly. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying this kind of as a joke, you know. I was supposed to do... never mind. So, anyways... we have to maintain our healing and maintain our deliverance, because what will happen is the enemy, Jesus sets you free by the blood, you're done. You're set free from something, you begin to walk things out. But you have to realize that you have to maintain that healing or that deliverance. So sometimes, even though I've been walking through this stuff with years and have access to good people that have heavy revelation on it, and they help me big time. Even with that, there's times that I'm walking and something goofy just tries to come right back on me. And so what the enemy will lie to you and say is you're really not free. If you were free, then you wouldn't have this, or you wouldn't deal with that, or fill in the blank. It's a lie. So you have to maintain your healing. You have to maintain your deliverance. And that's what Tamara did. So that's an important key point, is that our confession has to be, my confession daily is this, is I'm healed, maintaining my healing, and I'm delivered, maintaining my deliverance. Because I've realized that it's not just an event, it's a process. Sometimes it's like the layers of an onion. Sometimes God, you know, walks me through healing. He does things, you know, especially one of the most powerful things that he's done as of lately, the beginning of this year, was restore the relationship with my dad that I didn't have for a long, long time. That was heavy. Some of my earliest memories with my dad was fist fighting in the front yard. And now we have a healthy relationship. That's heavy. It also means that I'm walking through some things, because I grew up without him. I learned to be a man without him. But now, in realizing that honor of a mother and a father is huge on God's radar. You wanna get sideways with God, begin to dishonor a mother or a father. It's huge. It's huge on his radar. And I started seeing patterns and having all these issues. And when God restored those things, I'm walking through some stuff. I'm having to learn how to re-interact, because now, where I had a hindered relationship with men for the most part, now I'm able to have healthy relationships with men on a, you know, broad spectrum that I'm not used to. I was used to being selective. I would, you know, you're talking about praying and really seeking before I hung out with somebody. Because it seems like sooner or later they would try to attack you, or they felt threatened by you, and it was just something that was stirred up. Because why? I got off pattern here on the original man that God gave me was my dad. You get off on that when every man behind it is God bless you. God bless you twice. And so it's the same thing with the mother, you know, honoring a mother, having that relationship on, because if those relationships get off, they all get off. So we have to maintain our deliverance and our healing. That's a good point. I mean, just one of those deals. Well, we're going to close in prayer. Oh, did you want to say something?
Yeah. I just recognized the point you made about how the enemy plants the seed in the infancy stage. I'm an educator. I teach sixth graders.
Okay.
So I hang out with fifth and sixth graders every day. And you see the challenges every single day that they're coming with. Just their mindsets. They don't believe in themselves. They struggle in their education. And they don't, I mean, you're telling them every day, you can do it, you're smart, you're this. They do not believe it. And
yeah.
So it's just a constant, just trying to reprogram and just plant something in their minds as an educator that they can walk away with, even though they may be going back into environments where those other thoughts are being confirmed every day. But yeah.
And that's good, because, I mean, my earliest... thoughts, our earliest, some of my greatest moments that I remember that were just awesome moments of my childhood I started connecting the dots, and every single one of them outside of my family were with teachers. So outside of my family, teachers were the biggest influence on. Now, I had some teachers that said some horrible things. I had teachers that told me as a young kid that I was going to be in prison by the time I was 17. They were almost right. They were almost right. And so what she's saying is important, because here's the deal. When it comes to young people, we have to learn to speak to their spirit, not their head. I've learned that it works, and I do it all the time. I did it last night. You know, I was walking, got finished, you know, doing the singles ministry, walking out kind of late, and I hear a woman say, excuse me. She was lost, you know, bad lost, like people left her here. She don't know, you know. I'm like, do you have their phone number? No. I'm like, praise God. So they left you. You don't have their phone number here. So, but there was a young one there, you know, and he was just sitting there, and I realized that, man, this inconvenience is a moment. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It's a moment just to plant a seed. So I just looked at him in his eyes and I said, how are you doing, man of God? And he didn't know how to take it at first. But I'm speaking to his spirit. I'm telling him who he is. I don't know him. I don't know what he does. He may not act like that, but if I speak to his spirit, I'm prophesying. And it takes seeds. Mm-hmm. It takes seeds, and I can speak those things there. I can speak to their heart. So it's important as young people to speak to their heart. Now, as educators and just the way the system is, you know, they don't want young people knowing that. Because somebody knows who they are in Christ, they cannot easily be controlled or influenced by outside sources.
That's true.
And we have a system in the earth that wants to control people other than them being controlled by the will and the purpose of God. Can I get an amen on that one?
Amen.
And so they don't want you speaking to somebody's spirit. They don't want them knowing who they are in Christ. Because if they do, when somebody finds out who they are in Christ, they can find out what their purpose is.
Right.
When a man or a woman knows their purpose, they cannot be swayed by sin. They cannot be swayed by perversion. They cannot be swayed by all these other things, because that person knows their purpose on the inside. They know what they were born to do.
Wow.
And when you can answer that question, who am I and why am I here, baby, you are on your way. But some of us didn't have that.
Right.
So now as fixing to turn 40, I even hate saying that. I just tell everybody, I'm getting better. I mean, somebody try to say, you're going skydiving, man, you're 40. I'm like, man, I'm in my prime.
You know what I'm saying? You are.
Absolutely. Amen.
Because they program us to believe certain things. They program us to believe that 40 is some sort of mojo number. Like, when we get there, I don't even know where I got it from. I just heard it from other people that believe it. And so it's important to speak to people's hearts, to speak to their spirit. Speak to what you want. Don't speak to what you see. And so I also begin to sit there and tell that young man, I said, you know what? I can see in your eyes, you're intelligent. You're smart. I can see it all over you. I said, you have the call of God on your life. I mean, I was meant to say this stuff, and she began to cry.
Yes.
So we had a moment right there in front of the security guard who was getting grouchy. God bless his little heart. And so the whole deal is speak to their heart, speak to their spirit. Ma'am, did you have something? I saw your hand come up.
Yeah, could you give us a quick tip on how do you speak to thoughts when you don't really know what the words said? Like, let's say I didn't know what the words said about fear. How do I counteract
that? Sure. What you have is Holy Ghost revealed knowledge. It has to be revealed to you by the Spirit. Now, there's certain things we can just go to in the Word when it comes to fear. I don't have the spirit of fear, but of what? Power, love, and a sound mind.
Peace.
It's so funny that he ties fear and your mind together. Because the enemy, that's the battleground. So that's a good starting place, is to say, I do not have the spirit of fear, but I have but of power and of love and a sound mind. And so that's what you speak contrary. But what's even better than that, than somebody, you know, telling you, is for the Holy Spirit to reveal something to your heart. Because once he reveals it on a heart level, it's no longer head knowledge. It's revelation. It's prenostros. It's the highest form of knowledge. We have the written word. We have just the head knowledge. But then we have that knowledge that's revealed by the Holy Spirit here. And that's the highest level. That cannot be, the enemy cannot. All he can do is try to steal that from you. He cannot war against it because it's already revealed to you. So he'll begin to move in an area that you don't have revelation on, which takes me back to my original point. You have no problem in the earth but a knowledge problem. No matter what you're going through, the only problem you have is a knowledge problem. Amen. Is there any other questions around you? Father, we just thank you for every life that's here. I thank you for the word that's gone forth. I decree and declare that we have the mind of Christ, that we think the thoughts of God, that we're using wisdom in everything that we feed upon. Father, I take authority over any generational assignments launched against anybody's mind here. Father, I just break those curses. I uproot those supply lines in the name of Jesus. And I decree and declare that we are beginning to break thoughts and break thought patterns. Father, I thank you for your anointing on each and every person's life here, Father, to be a doer of the word and not just a hearer. Father, I plead for your mercy over their life. I thank you that you take them to the cleft of your hiding place, far above all principalities and the warfare, Lord, that would try to launch against their life to bring them to a place of bondage or defeat. And so, Father, I thank you right now that their thoughts are clear. Father, that they're free from all bondage. Lord, that you're giving them strategic revelation knowledge on how to deal with their specific situations, whatever's coming against their mind, whether it's defeat, whether it's loneliness, whether it's hopelessness. Father, we thank you right now that there's a divine turnaround in the thought lives of your people, that we no longer give up ground. And so, Father, I thank you right now that there's strength in us, that you're speaking these things to us by your Spirit. And Father, by the revelation knowledge is being released into the hearts and into the minds of those that are here, Father, they begin to act on the word. And Father, we bless you and thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank y'all so much for coming. Amen.